Yeah, thank you very much. So I'm quite sure that you will not fall asleep. This talk is not very technical. If somebody of you wants to know or ask technical questions, please simply do. Not at latest in the question and answers at the end, but you can even ask in between. Okay, so let me start. So Blue Yonder is actually a company that from Germany that stands for digital innovation and disruption, and is originating from CERN, the largest particle collider of the world, where I worked directly for 6.5 years, but that's a long time ago already. But as professor at the Karlsruhe Institute of Technology, I also had groups working at, or still have groups still working at CERN, and also at Fermilab in the US and KEK in Japan, and so that is altogether now the large particle colliders of the world. We have won a lot of prizes, and I don't want to go into any detail. What we're trying to do is to bring value into businesses, right, through data and scientific software. Oops. That is way too fast. I think this is somehow the wrong. Yes, it's a talk that I want to give tomorrow. Oh my God! Too bad, too bad. Yeah, where's the right one? Just thinking, this cannot be. Yes, this looks better. Okay, very sorry for that. Okay, so this, what you see there in the background is a picture of one of the detectors at CERN. Where at CERN we had big data already for a very long time. So nowadays when the collider runs there, about 1 petabyte per second in raw data is taken. But this is way too much to store all this and analyze it. And it's online already by some 30,000 computers in parallel. It's online reduced by a factor of 1 to 100 million about, because most of the stuff that is seen there is already known. It's uninteresting. It's known physics, and that we try to reduce at the very, very early at the beginning. So, and what we are, oh my God, this is really very bad. I just show you some things where what we did with neural networks. Very often it is finding signals, finding new particles, for example, in combinatorial background, and this is shown then as peaks in histograms. So on the left there you see that it was a very well-known particle. On the right, this peak there, on the huge background, that was not so very well-known. It's a particle that was discovered actually in 2004. And also with the help of, or it was confirmed with this plot here, with the help of our neural network. And this algorithm was, for example, able for itself to make from that signal to noise this one by learning what's different here in this region compared to the sidebands. And I have another example of this also. Shown here. So if you are a researcher and you want to find a signal in that plot up there, you would say first, oh, there is nothing. So what one usually does is one does some selections. One looks for if this variable is energy or so is larger than that and that, and some other criteria, then you lose statistics, but you hope that you enrich the signal and get rid of background more. And this was done now by a neural network, which simply tried to learn, am I here in this region or am I here in that region? Right, so it's simply, and then you cut on the neural network and then look at the distribution again and see, ah, right, there's a small bump coming up there. And then you do the same thing again and you go there, and then you do the same thing again and you get a signal like this here. If you do it somewhere where you expect no particle, this does not work and it stays flat. So you can build algorithms just from neural networks that help you to detect things, signals in lots of noise, and this here is just from data. There's no simulation model, nothing. The only thing that we used here is that we knew there's a particle with this mass, so it must be here in this band. Right? So if there are researchers in here that do things like that, there's another tip. You can do it even better by not defining a signal region and background region, but something which is called the S-plot method, where you know you have a more or less Gaussian or some shape of a signal and another shape which is more usually much flatter, more evenly distributed for background. And then from such signals, you can use the whole information to get, for example, something like this, also a large improvement of signal to noise. So what we did is that with, I say it like that, or that at least we sell it like this when we talk to customers, we replaced the work of very intellectual work of PhD students, postdocs, professors, so researchers in artificial in elementary particle physics by artificial intelligence. Because this is from an experiment in Japan, and I had about 50 PhD students working there, so I knew really how this stuff worked. Right, and so we, then at some stage we made a meta-analysis and said, my God, all these PhD theses, the statistical analysis are similar again and again. So can we, do we have to do really for each analysis again, a design of the analysis and background subtraction procedures again and again? And we said, no, in principle, one can, in all these analyses, we had a hierarchical model of what has to be done, and we found that altogether it's exactly 72 decisions that such a researcher has to take. And for all of these decisions, we trained neural networks to optimize these, to get optimal signal to noises. Right? And then we ran this program on all the data that the experiment has taken in 10 years, over 10 years, and this was analyzed by 400 physicists from 450 physicists from all over the world, including myself and my group. And what came out was that compared to what the 400 physicists had done over 10 years, this program was 2 times more, so 100% more effective in finding these beam mesons where the experiment was built for. So we could do twice as much, get twice as much output of the data. That is another selection there. So the upper plot is what was achieved by hand, and the lower plot here, it was not cut on same efficiency, but on same signal size. And you see that the artificial intelligence could reduce the background, the unwanted background reactions, by far compared to what humans achieved in over 10 years. Right? And this was a work by artificial intelligence, or 72 neural networks and 3 PhD students who programmed it, right? And it corresponded to the amount of about 500 normal PhD theses, and corresponds to another 10 years of data taking. The cost of 10 years of data taking for that experiment is 700 million euros. So I was quite proud of about that. That is not so bad. Now, in the meantime, that was published in 2011. In the meantime, there's a new experiment built. It's the same place in Japan. And now we have rewritten this again with all what we know in between. Now it's another factor of 2 beta. Now it's 4 times human performance, right? And it's faster. It's rewritten in Python, by the way. The original one was C++. And now it will not run in future 10 years after data taking and after we had all the experience, but now the raw data comes out of the detector through a computer and completely reconstructed every event. Right? So that means that the physicists themselves and PhD students will go one on the meta level, right? So they can do what was done for 35 years and made more than half of the work for a PhD thesis or a research is not necessary anymore. It's done automatically. 4 times better than by humans. Right? Okay, and that is another thing. Also in that respect, particle physics has this very, very huge data rates. And for the new experiment in Japan, the innermost detector produces so much data that it's not possible to read it out into 30,000 computers anymore, parallel computers. But it's simply too much. And what we built there is now we put such a decision algorithm directly onto the sensor itself, right? So that the sensors are read out only if the algorithm already decides, this part of the detector is interesting, and we want to have it. Otherwise, it's not read out into any computer anymore, right? So, and this chip, actually, I think it's a world record. It does 8 billion decisions per second, massively parallel. Okay, so this I have shown you already in the other talk. The rest of the session, I want to talk about decision making in enterprises, and decision making, decision optimization and automation under uncertainty. Okay, so I think even there was lots of criticism already on the term artificial intelligence, and most of the stuff I agree completely with. And for sure, humans will not be so fast replaced in decision making of our important personal and also professional decisions that are once in a lifetime decisions, or similar seldom decisions, for sure not. There, our human gut feeling is something that is very good, and for sure this will not be automated. So these are questions like, should I marry this woman? This will never be automated, right? So we will do it, hopefully. Should Britain have a Brexit? Okay, this is clear, but sometimes you see humans the suboptimal answer. Okay, but many decisions in our life, and especially also in enterprises, are operational decisions which are more or less the same every day, right? And I think this is more than 99% of all the decisions that have to be taken, right? And as an example, I want to talk about retail. We can automate 99% of the decisions by artificial intelligence and with data-driven algorithms. So what kind of decisions are these? These are repeated decisions. For example, in retail, which of my 20,000 items should I reorder today, right? And how many in each store? Right? Or what is the best price for this article for tomorrow? Right? Or whom should I send this expensive catalog? I have 5 million customers in my database, and one of these catalogs cost £2, and to send it away even more. So these are questions that come again and again. Of course, we have data on this. We have experience on this, or a retailer has data. And the question is, how can one optimize the decisions? So first, I want to tell you a bit how the human decision works. So most of the time, people, if they ask, now decide, they do nothing. Nothing also comprises do the same as always, right? So what did we do yesterday? Or what did we do last year? That's, by the way, by far most decisions in enterprises are we do the same as yesterday or we do the same as last year. By far the most, right? It's okay, some companies have business rules. That's already much better. Can be good, but can also be often also comes to a limit, and usually then they are a bit old, and sometimes they are also wrong. And I will show later they cannot handle all the situations, and that an employee now sits down and thinks, how many should I order of these apples now? Our competitor has a promotion right now, but the weather, it's raining so much, there are less people coming. And so how often does it happen? It happens, yes, from time to time, but not every day in every store for every article. So this year is something that humans, although we are able to do it, usually don't do. And to understand this, or to make it clear, you have to know how the human brain works. And this is also, by the way, something artificial intelligence has to do at some stage. So we have two decision-making systems in our brains. The first one is a fast, intuitive one. And almost 100% of our decisions are done by system one. And this does not cost very much energy. I give you an example. I drive home from work, and then I'm my head is, I'm thinking about what happened today, how we should decide this, and why this bloody customer made this into a statement, and so on. Right? And then I'm at home in the garage, and then I close off, and then I'm, oh my God, how did I come here? I don't even know, right? The whole driving I made completely automatically. So these were hundreds of decisions, when to brake, when to, right? When to accelerate, when to do, when to blink, and so on. All these things were done more or less automatically. So this is a fast, intuitive system, and most stuff, most decisions are done by that. Also, most of our buying decisions. And then we have, as humans, our slow, rational decision system. That is really thinking, right? Really reasoning, calculating, building statistics, stuff like that. Right? So of course, humans can do this, and this is a big difference to other animals, but very often we don't use it, although we should. Right? And so in a professional life, of course, we should use reasoning and don't do whatever we want. Now, the system one of our human decision making has some nice features, and if you don't know all of this already, then I can recommend this book here by Daniel Kahneman, Nobel Prize winner. And also there's another book by Dan Ariely, also very good. They made lots of tests, and so they really research, and this is written very elegantly and well understandable and readable in these books. And so there they yeah, there's lots of research about how this works. And so one of the main theses there is that lots of our system one decisions, the emotional fast ones, have lots of biases, right? And yeah, I tell you only one, the IKEA effect, for example. IKEA effect means that we think something is more valuable if we also did a little bit of work in producing this. And then we think it's really worth, yeah, it's more worth it. Okay, it is simply like that. And there are long lists of these so-called cognitive biases, also to be found on the internet. It's very and all in these books, very, very interesting. The funny thing is everybody has it, also I have it. And so it is, we are built like that. We were formed like that in the evolution. It was very important that we had these effects or these biases in order to survive. Right? But now we are not living, we don't have to fight a tiger anymore or so, but now we have to fight, yeah, whatever, Amazon or so. You know, it's changed completely, right? So our a retailer has to at least to take care of Amazon. Okay. So I will come to, I show you one such effect here, a graph about that, and that's very important. Now, I think, and that's what we are doing, that predictive analytics and prescriptive analytics are the two are sub-disciplines of machine learning, and today you subsume all of this under artificial intelligence. And I show you now how these two things can help to do much better decisions as a human usually does. So, and for a scientist, and probably for most of you, you would always argue, yeah, but what does he tell us? That's, of course, normal. But most of the decisions, for sure, in industry and economy are not taken like this. So you start off with objective data, right? To make a good decision, you want to know how was it up to now, right? What is the connection between whatever. How was all the experience, so all your sales numbers of all your products for many years you want to have and know. Right? You start with objective data. To have data is always better than not to have data. Right? And then you do predictions for the near future, for example, on demand for tomorrow. So how many apples are sold in this shop on the other side of the street tomorrow? I had a prediction. I say something about how to do this prediction in a minute. One very important thing is that this prediction has an uncertainty, right? So I talk about that. Then you have to know, okay, what happens if the if the real demand is higher or lower than I expect, what is the cost or the utility of that? You have to have a cost and utility function, and then you can do an optimization to find the right decision. Right, so finally you have to make a decision. I order today 80 pieces of this kind of apples, right? And so if you do that for many, then and it's an algorithm behind it, then you also can automate that. So when can we use predictive analytics? For that, and I think probably for you, it's all of you, it is clear, but my experience is that most people have a way too deterministic view of the world. As a physicist, one can calculate what happens there exactly, right? That is not a problem. And so it is, we all think the world is deterministic. Yeah? But this system is only slightly more complicated, and we cannot predict anything, right? The drawing of lottery numbers. It is, so every week exactly the same happens, but every time other numbers are drawn, right? And this is so-called deterministic chaos. You can even prove that it's unpredictable what happens there, right? Although it's also a simple mechanical system, right? The only difference is that here are more so-called breaking points in between, right? So, for example, if one of the balls goes like this, it falls down. And if it's just a nanometer more to the right, it is reflected at the edge here. So, and that means the original state space is only a very tiny deviation, right? But the end result is completely different. And if you have many of such division points, then what happens is completely unpredictable. And this happens very, very fast. Right? And, now the good thing is that almost everything interesting in our world is something in between there, right? So it is neither completely deterministic. For sure, it's not deterministic how many of these apples are sold tomorrow in the store over there, right? But it's also not completely random, because we know on average they sell so and such, and it is, has such a weak profile and depends on the season and blah, 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 right? And so it's a mixture of these. There's a predictable part and there's a random unpredictable part, right? And, then of course the question, when you try to make a forecast, what can you use? Right, and there you see you can think about many possible influences and you try to get hold of as many data as possible in order to make such a prediction. For example, price, promotions, local competitor, competitor price, competitive articles, coupon promotion, TV ads, print, online promotions, seasonality, local holidays, day of the week, brand, weather, and even the weather forecast for the next weekend, depending on the article, but for example, for barbecue meat and so on, this might be very important. And then, of course, you need lots of data in order to for doing it. So you don't do it for just one item. It works well if you have many items in a store. Yeah? So typical is 20,000 or 40,000 for a retailer. And you have many stores, not only one. So 500 or 1,000 or 2,000 or 10,000, depending on the chain. And you have also a long history of data. So you have many days. And if you have this, then you easily get a very, very large data set, right? So this can then be 25 billion rows of a matrix, right? And the column of the matrix is all the stuff, or can be built from all the stuff that I have shown here, and especially also the sales, and I think they are missing here, really the sales number from yesterday, the day before, last one day, and so on. And all this. So you can build a large matrix out of that. And then you use some machine learning procedure in order to learn what will happen tomorrow. Now the standard or legacy approach, and in all the ERP systems which are on the market, they have a forecast module, but the forecast is one number. Even the interfaces only have place for one number. So for example, 265 of these apples, right, in that store tomorrow. For us, a prediction is something completely different. Why? Because we know it is it will not be 265, very probably not. Right? It can also 266, 67, 78, or 300, or 350, or 120. And for us, a prediction is a complete probability distribution for each of the possible outcomes in the future. Right? So this, from the mathematical point of view, is what we can say about the future, not more. Not more. Right? And sometimes it's quite narrow. That means we can make an exact prediction. And sometimes it's very broad, uncertain. For example, when it's a new article and we don't know, do not have any experience with that one, then it's also broader and we do not know it so well. Or if it's very weather sensitive and I should make a prediction about in a fortnight, and we know all, in a fortnight we can't predict the weather very well. We can do it for tomorrow and the day after. And 1 week, it gets worse and worse, right? But in 2 weeks, that's essentially random, then it also gets broader, right? So that's, and with that here is, you do not only have the mean value, but also a measure of variance, the maximum likelihood, but also you can calculate all the quantiles, right? And you can calculate, if you, for example, have the demand that you are allowed only in 5% to be out of stock or in 1% out of stock, then you can calculate where you are here. Okay, and if you have many of these here, and a usual, let's say for a usual retailer, one has about, if you do this here now for 1 day, 2 day, and so on, up to 3 weeks in advance, then one has something like 200 million or 500 million such predictions in form of probability density distributions. And then you do, I skipped one transparency. I'm not used to use this here, and this is bad. So it stores this thing still. It's too slow, and then I move already, and then it's bad. Okay, I start to understand. Okay, I want to show this here. It's also now important, how do we come to the best decision? That is called prescriptive analytics. That gives, a retailer cannot use a probability distribution. He wants to know, how many should I order? So I should give him a recipe, order 8. Something like that, right? So how do we get it? We get it by knowing, we have to calculate the expected cost or utility, right, for this probability distribution. And this, of course, is also at, as a function of the decision, how many I actually order. And then now it's clear, if, for example, if it's sushi or ground beef, you have to sell it in 2 days, then you have to throw it away, right? There's a cost of ordering too many is very large. Right. Of course, you also don't want to be out of stock. On the other hand, but it's always a compromise, of course. For articles with a very short shelf life, it's way more dangerous to order too many, as for example for wine. Right. So if you don't sell the wine tomorrow, then you sell it next week or next year. Right. So depending on the target article itself, the cost or utility function looks very different and can be very asymmetric. Okay, and now you have many of these, many of the decisions, many recipes, then you start to automate. So one thing that is possible here, and maybe this is not probably not very well known to many people, a decision under uncertainty always is a compromise, right? And you can only improve one KPI by hurting the other. So if our KPIs, for example, out of stock rate and write-off, right, so then if you order more, then you have lower out of stock rate, but many write-offs, right? And if you order less, then you have a few write-offs, but a high out of stock rate, right? And your decision is somewhere on this line. That here will also be always stay a human decision. Where do I want to be? That's a strategy of the retailer. Where do I want to be? But now due to our procedure, we actually go to a better working point, right? So So the CEO or whoever decides, okay, I want to be there on that curve, but then all the operational decisions are aligned to the strategical goal, and by that you come to a better curve. So it's somehow like portfolio theory. If you do things under uncertainty on many, many, many things, and the predictions are right, right, then sometimes you have fluctuations upwards and sometimes downwards, right? And on average, by aligning all the decisions to the same strategy, you then simply go to a way better point. So altogether, you have then less out of stock and less write-offs. And that's, of course, what a company leader wants to have, right? He wants to make a decision which all the, or many, exclusive or excluding KPIs are all becoming better. So and that is possible, and that's what we regularly achieve. Okay, now the influence of automation, and that is, this year is really stunning. So that was from a German supermarket chain out of stock rate as a function of time, at an overall constant overall stock level and waste rate. So it started off before we made the project, they had about 7.5% out of stock items. So 70.5% of all articles were not available on shelf. Right? So then it started there, you see it went down to 6% or 5%. That was a time when actually the people, the employees got lists with recipes. So they said, order 8 of these and 20 of those and 120 of that. But they were still allowed to do what they wanted, right? And what they did is that some accepted this and others did not. And usually they think, but look, my gut feeling tells me no more here, less there. And they have a feeling. Nobody wanted to compromise this. They wanted really to do the best, but they didn't do the best. And at that day here, then the CEO said, okay, it seems to work. Now let's try it full automatically. And what happened then is what you see there. And so it was another factor of 10 improvement. And that was because all the human biases were now eliminated. And this is what we very often see. Actually, there's also academic research about it, especially this problem. Decisions under uncertainty, humans are very, very bad. And so they made a test even with professors who teach stuff like that. Right? If they are in a situation, in a game situation where they should order with the information that I just gave you, they made it with experienced retailers, with new students, and with professors. And all three groups were bad in doing it actually in the game, whether they understood the mathematics behind it or not. It's simply because our system one works like that, and also the professors don't think and calculate in each single decision. It is like that. That's how humans behave. Okay, so artificial intelligence, supply chain optimization in retail, that are numbers that we achieve there. 99% automation, so only very special cases like Christmas or so are still done by hand, others not. Less write-offs, less waste, actually, just due to our work, the waste rate of food in supermarkets went down already quite a bit for those who are using it. More freshness, also by better, the mean shelf lifetime of articles in the shelf is longer when we do it this way. Less capital binding, less out of stock, more turnover, more efficiency. So this is, all the quantities are positive, and usually with one single decision, it's impossible to do it. 10 minutes, okay. Okay, let me be then a bit faster there. So one thing where we did this here is the UK supermarket chain Morrisons in the last 2 years. And Morrisons is number 4 in UK and had quite some problems, but now it has a complete turnaround and was from this summer, was a shop or store of the week, with especially store, well, the availability score optimal, so things are there, but also then store standard, shop floor service, also best nodes. Why? Because the people now have time again for their customers, right? And don't have to sit in front of a screen and work only there, type in millions of numbers. So if you see it even on the stock market, this is the Morrison's stock price in the last 2 years, plus 50%. And this is the overall UK retail stock index, minus 25%. Not only due to this, but also due to that. And that was, okay, again, this year is just from 2 weeks ago, from the half year 2017, profit jumped 40%. And so the CEO and CFO, so you are not very technical, make even statements like, yeah, especially high on service availability. Our new automated stock ordering system is improving availability and freeing up time, blah, 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 and so on. Significant cost saving, improving availability, reducing stock holding, and so it really works. They live it. Okay, and last week, Morrison's and Blue Yonder got a prize for that here. That was, of course, very nice. So in Germany, we do it, for example, for Kaufland, something similar for fresh meat, and there we even pass this information back to up the complete supply chain, up to the meat production plant, right? And so the most modern meat factory in Europe is only possible to work because it has not a storage anymore at all, and whatever they do there, produce there, so kill animals, right? And make meat out of it is directly really, so they print exactly then the pricing for exactly that store directly there. So usually it was just first produced, stored, and then in the second step it was distributed. That is now in one go. And that improves the effective shelf life by 1 day. So it's enormous, and yeah, the number of cattle killed there is now much less. Okay, another thing, predictive shipping for online marketplace goes very similar. Also there, 99% automation. This is from Otto, so a big German distance seller with lots of sub-companies, actually number two worldwide after Amazon altogether. Their delivery went from 5 to 7 days to 1 to 2 days. So by predicting what article will be ordered by their clients tomorrow and the day after, so and so on in the near future. So that is already then brought into their very small storage and sent further. Turnover increased, customer satisfaction increased, returns and online business went down, storage went down, and deliveries per order went down. And okay, I have to be fast. I will just say this. Also in pricing, it works. Pricing, also 99% automation, market share improved, turnover improved, raw profit improved, customers, more customers, more new customers, so that's for sure not by being too expensive, right? Less returns also here, zero complaints in contrast to what was expected before, and way more rest at the end of the season, so also there it brings very much. So I think I have to skip this, unfortunately. At the end, I just want to say, I think what we deliver there is real. This is a package solution, end-to-end solution, where we try to hide all the complexity, all the mathematical and data science complexity. And this is really solves a problem for the market, right? A retailer has such problems, and he just wants to have a solution for that. And we combine our expert know-how, domain knowledge, with our expert knowledge in machine learning and enterprise software expertise to package this all together in consumable, robust solutions for specific tasks, ready to deliver proven value and competitive advantage. This is provided as a service in the cloud. And if you want, as I sometimes asked, is it then replacing ERP systems. No, we say not. It's just an intelligence system layer on top of existing ERP systems, then you, because you need all the numbers, of course, right? And of course, also the single orders, we also feed back into the existing ERP system, and it's then automatically transferred to the vendors. Yes, and I think that Blue Yonder is a first mover in this area, but I think it's very important. So this stuff is existing. It is not very far future. It is existing and really brings value right now. One thing which is difficult is the adoption rate of many companies is slow, and there's still lots of resistance in accepting methods like these. Wherever we do it, and then of course we can always measure it easily in A/B tests. So part of the locations or part of the articles are handled by this system, part by the old system, and then you very, very easily see the advantages of this system. But still, often it takes long to accept this. I think retail is a good market for us because retail has very small margins, very small profit margins, in the region of 1-3% usually. And of course, there are strong attacks by Amazon on one hand, and by the German discounters Aldi and Lidl on the other hand. And so, in this very competitive environment, it is clear that normal retailers cannot just continue like that. They will have no chance, right? And so that's why I think that retail, where first you think, oh, but they are probably not the most modern and innovative people. They have to, and that's why they are quite advanced there. So thank you very much for your attention.